Miss John is ready to take them to Children's Church. Please go worship with them. Y'all are having a great time learning about Jesus. And then you'll be back in here with us. Want to talk about prophecy, huh? If your children are with you today, Miss John is ready to take them to Children's Church. Please go worship with them. Y'all are having a great time learning about Jesus. And then you'll be back in here with us at the end of the service. All right? God bless y'all. Take your Bibles this morning and turn to the book of Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. And also, put your finger in Zechariah. Now that's, you can go to the middle of the Bible. You know, the last book of the Old Testament is Malachi. And the book before that is Zechariah. Okay? So go to Zechariah chapter 9 and put your finger there. Just keep it there. We'll get to it pretty quick here this morning, but not for a little bit, but just keep your finger there. Little four-year-old Marcy was eating in a restaurant with her parents, and she kept staring at this young couple in the restaurant who were hugging and kissing. And finally, she says to her mama, "Mama, why does he keep whispering in her mouth?" In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we have the story of the Passion Week. But what we know from history is that Mark is the one who originally wrote about it. And then Matthew and Luke, they wrote after Mark did and used Mark's writing as their springboard for their letter. And then John comes along 30 years after that, and he writes about it. And so there's little discrepancies as far as you think they don't exactly line up when you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They kind of okay. But there's some times, there's one time specifically that John looks like maybe it's not in agreement with. But after you study, and I spent 2 days just trying to make those things harmonize this week, and they do. And I was wrong. I thought they didn't, but they do. Always this, guys, when it seems that the Bible contradicts itself, it doesn't. Just needs more study, that's all. And a little more study revealed to me that I was wrong, and once again, this was right. Matthew chapter 26, I'll tell you what let's do. You know, to honor God this morning as we read, why don't you stand with me? We're going to read several different passages, so we'll start in Matthew chapter 26. Verse 1 through 5, and don't get weary. Just remember, I had to stand up here the whole time. Y'all can sit down just a minute. Matthew chapter 26, verse 1. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "As you know, the Passover is in 2 days, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people assembled in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and they plotted to arrest Jesus in some sly way and kill him. But not during the feast, they said, or there may be a riot among the people." Now skip down to verse 17. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and they asked, "Where do you want us to make preparation for you to eat the Passover?" And he replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him the teacher says, 'My appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. Now skip down, if you would, to verse 30. When they had sung a hymn, this after they had eaten, and they sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Now go to chapter 27 and look at verse 26. Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him, and they stripped him, they put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. And after they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him and then led him away to be crucified. Now skip down to verse 45. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling on Elijah." And immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. And the rest said, "Now, leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes and saves him." And when Jesus had cried out in a loud voice, he gave up or dismissed his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. And when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God."
Amen.
Father God, I pray today that as we rehearse for ourselves and remind ourselves day by day and hour by hour what took place, that we can relive and reappreciate what our Savior went through to purchase our salvation. We thank you for that. We thank Jesus for that today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You can be seated. The city, Jerusalem. Why Jerusalem? Jesus and his disciples went to Jerusalem to observe the Passover. As every good Jew did, they went to Jerusalem to celebrate. The Passover was the oldest and the largest of six feasts that they celebrated every year. Jerusalem was not a large city at that time. It was a city of about 200,000 people. That sounds large to me, but it wasn't very large at that time. But get this. On this particular Passover, though the city was only about 200,000, they had over 2 million guests who came to the city to celebrate Passover. Wow. They did not have enough Days Inn and Motel 6 for them. And so they had to camp everywhere, anywhere they could, but 2 million people came and gathered at Jerusalem. Why such a crowd? I mean, was it always like that? No, that's why they recorded that on this particular Passover, it was extra large. But why? Because the name of Jesus was on everybody's lips this particular time. Everybody knew of his clashes with the scribes and Pharisees. And they knew how Jesus, with great courage, had stood against their teaching to tell them the truth about what they were falsely saying. And they also knew of the determination of the religious leaders to get rid of Jesus. So a feeling of expectancy possessed the crowd. Nothing like a good old showdown to get a crowd together, right? And so here's the showdown between the religious leaders and Jesus. Who's going to win? So here's the daily schedule as it begins. So take your piece of paper that we gave you when you came in today, and I want you to fill in the blanks today as we go down through here. So I'm giving you the days as we go, and you can write down what happened on those days. I'll give it to you. But you know what? They say that what you hear, what you retain, what you write down you retain for 72 hours. No, what you hear you retain for only 72 hours. But what you write down, you will retain for 7 days. So I want you to retain. I mean, we're here for retention, right? And so that being the case, you write. You say, "But I don't write fast." That's okay. I'm just slow enough you can write. On Friday, Jesus arrived in Bethany. Now, you know Bethany. Bethany is the city where, remember Jesus' friend who passed away, Lazarus? He lived in Bethany. And Jesus went to Bethany to raise him from the dead. Remember that? First time I went to Israel, we had a Palestinian guide. And we went other places. But before he took us to Jerusalem, the night, we went in the evening time and we stopped at Bethany to what's to be the tomb of Lazarus. Is where we went first there in Bethany. And then we proceeded to Jerusalem. He wanted us to take the same trip that Jesus took at this time. And so Bethany was about a mile and a half from Jerusalem. To put that in perspective for you, from where you're seated right now, Dollar General is 2.1 miles. So Bethany was 0.6 of a mile closer than that. So it wasn't very far, all right? And so he stayed there in the home of one of his friends, Simon the leper, a man who had leprosy, but Jesus had healed him, and now Jesus is there and staying in his home. They're friends together, and it was the Jewish Sabbath, and Jesus comes there on Friday. You say, I thought the Sabbath was on Saturday. It is, but the Jewish Sabbath started at 6 o'clock on Friday and went to 6 o'clock on Saturday, and so when sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday, and so it's the Jewish Sabbath when he arrives in Bethany. The next day is Saturday. That's the Sabbath for the Jews. And so, as was Jesus' custom on Saturday, which would have been yesterday, we're trying to put this in order for you. So this week, so Friday he would arrive at Bethany. Then yesterday on Saturday he would have gone into the synagogue, which was his custom, and worship. And so that's what he did on the Sabbath day. And then on Sunday, that is today, on Palm Sunday, we call it. The Triumphal Entry Sunday, we call it. On Sunday, not a peaceful, quiet Sunday. Remember, Saturday was their Sunday. Sunday was our Monday. And so Sunday was a work day. And so when he comes into Jerusalem from Bethany, it's not on the quiet Sunday that we think about, but it was on the work day, the first work day of the week, and some people were in the marketplace going here and there. Now, I told you to put your finger in Zechariah chapter 9. We're going to read that. Zechariah 9:9. There's a prophecy here that's fulfilled over in the scripture we just read. Zechariah says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, a foal of a donkey." Now, here is what's taking place. Christ comes in riding on a donkey, declaring his messiahship in this triumphal entry. I've got the two words there, horse and donkey. Horse is associated with war. When a prince was going to declare war on another people, he would come riding on a war horse. And so when he started coming towards you on that war horse, you knew you better get ready for battle. But when that prince was coming to you on a peaceful mission, instead of a war horse, he came riding on a donkey. That was his way of saying non-verbally, don't worry about it, there's no war taking place, I'm coming in peace. And so Jesus comes to them in Jerusalem, not on a horse, but riding on a donkey, to say to them, I want you to know I'm coming in peace. And so they took off their clothes as they saw him coming. And the people, and they gathered after all. They came in for the Passover. They were there. And they began to take off their clothes and palm branches, lay them in the path. And the multitudes began to hail him, Hosanna in the highest. And most of us, our heads would begin to swell. Yeah, that's me. But not Jesus. Jesus heard them, but he also knew that these very same well-wishers in just a few days would be saying, crucify him, crucify him. And he knew that because he was God in flesh. He was all-knowing, so he knew what was going to take place. He already knew all these folks would be calling for his death. So as he rounded the point of the Mount of Olives, and that's the way you come in from Bethany, you come around the point and you come around, the city of Jerusalem bursts into view, and now there's that gold dome that you look at, and you're sitting at the top of the Mount of Olives. And the Mount of Olives at that time was about a mile long, and a whole mile of olive trees on this mountain, and it was divided into different gardens. Somebody on this section, that was their garden. This was somebody else's garden. And later on, we're going to read where he went to the Garden of Gethsemane. He went to somebody's garden to pray there on the Mount of Olives. So he rounds the point of the Mount of Olives and turns north to the Kidron Valley. And the way it is, it's like that's the Mount of Olives and Jerusalem's over here. Between the two, there's this great valley, and that valley is called the Kidron Valley. And so he comes around the Mount of Olives, he comes down a hill to the Kidron Valley, and he goes past the golden gate of the temple, and he goes back up to the temple area, and then he goes into the temple, and as he goes into the temple here on Sunday, their first day of their work week, what does he do? He heals the blind, he heals the sick, he heals the lame. He's teaching the whole time. He's not just healing, he's talking, he's teaching the whole time. And then evening on Sunday, he returns to Bethany. Mile and a half, easy walk, easy ride, and he goes back to sleep. On Monday, tomorrow, when you wake up, look at your mirror and read what he did tomorrow. He entered Jerusalem to teach and to heal. Then he goes back to Bethany to rest. Then on Tuesday, he goes back into Jerusalem to teach and to heal. Back to Bethany to rest. On Wednesday, he stays in Bethany. See, he, being God, knows what's ahead. And so on Wednesday, he doesn't leave Bethany. He stays there to rest. He knows he needs his strength because he knows what's coming the next day and the day after. Thursday, the day of the Passover. He has already sent two of his disciples ahead to Jerusalem. We read that a while ago. And said, go prepare the Passover for us. They believe that it was probably one of the disciples' father's homes on his roof where they went to take the Passover meal. And the Passover, as you know, was a choice lamb, and it was roasted whole. And there was unleavened bread because this was the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which meant for seven straight days the people could not eat any leavened bread. Remember, leaven is a symbolism for evil. And so they couldn't have any leaven in their house during this whole time because that would symbolize they had sin in their house. And so that had to be gone. So for 7 days they ate no leavened bread. So they had unleavened bread, they had wine, and it was fermented wine. Not grape juice like my mama thought. And they had bitter herbs. At sunset, the trumpet would sound. You know, you can still today in some of those Middle East countries, there's this crying and praying or singing out. You can hear them all over the city. But back then they played a trumpet, and when the trumpet would blast, the Passover meal would begin. Everybody would eat together. It was a celebration, if you remember, of the deliverance of their forefathers out of Egyptian bondage. Remember when Moses went to Pharaoh and said, let my people go, and all the plagues took place. And finally, Pharaoh said, just get out of here. And when they got out, he said, God said to them, from now on, you will celebrate this. You'll tell all your kids about this. Every generation is going to remember it. This is the Passover. This is when you put the blood over the doorpost, and every home that had the blood over the doorpost, the death angel passed over. And thus the term Passover feast. They didn't kill anybody in that home. The Passover feast was celebrated. And so Thursday's day, the schedule of events, here's what took place. That evening, he entered Jerusalem before 6 o'clock. They had to be there before they had the upper room. And the first thing he does is he doesn't eat, but instead he takes his time and he teaches a lesson on humility to his disciples. Remember, he put the towel about himself and he got down to wash their feet. And that was a way of saying, I'm your servant. I'm here to serve you. Now, they knew that he was their king. But he said, I'm a servant king. And what he was saying to them and to us is, we too are to be servants. And never forget that. So he taught this lesson of humility first. And then at that meal, that's when he identified Judas as the traitor who was going to betray him. And then he ate with his disciples what's known as the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. Now we call it communion or the Lord's Supper today. And that's when he said, This is my body, which is going to be broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is my blood, which is spilled for you. And then he gave them this great farewell speech. You know, we don't get all of it. But can't you just imagine? He speaks and say to every one of them, this is your strength. This is what's good about you. This is what you do best. Now use that and do this. And here's what's good about you. Use that and do best. And so he spoke to these 11 disciples who were left. As he's saying goodbye to them. Then he says, so guys, I want to go out now to the Mount of Olives. I want to go to Gethsemane to pray. Takes him with him. Goes out, begins to pray. As you read there, he knows what's coming. And he says to his father, he says, listen, if there's any way this cup can pass me where I don't have to go through with this. See, he knew what pain he was fixing to suffer. He said, if there's any other way, he's saying this, whereby men might be saved, except for me to have to die, Father, please let this cup pass from me. Let's find another way if there's any way possible. But there wasn't. So they came to arrest him. Sometime right before midnight on Thursday night. Here's why that's important. Remember the scripture talks about 3 days in the grave? Okay? Keep that. This is important. So just remember that. 3 days in the grave. So it's right before midnight. So by midnight, Friday, this is his last earthly day. Okay? So beside Friday, right out, last earthly day. At midnight, a multitude of trials began. One says, I find no fault in him. Send somebody else. I find no fault in him. Send somebody else. I find no fault in him. Send somebody else. I mean, over and over. Everybody's trying to find someone to let him go. But the Jewish leaders say, no. No, we don't want you to let him go. We brought him to you. Now do something with him. So at 7 a.m., all the trials are ended now. And that's where Pilate says, go flog him and get rid of him. You won't let me release Barabbas to you, so just get rid of him. So the trials end and the scourging begins. Scourging. That's where they whipped him. With what some call it a thong, some call it whips, some call it a cat of nine tails. One man would have a whip, long leather straps. On the end of it would be like an acorn shaped ball of lead. And coming out of that acorn ball shape of lead would be a bone with a hook on it or spikes. And they would hit whoever they were going to hit with that. And the pieces of bone were very sharp. They stripped him of his clothes. They tied his hands on a collar. They bent his back. And he was lashed with those cat of nine tails. And those instruments of torture were delivered with severity almost to the point of death. And here's why it was almost the point of death. If they made the mistake and killed him, whichever one did so would be killed themselves. So they knew just how much they could flog him and him still be alive. See, the Romans were experts in torture. And they wanted you to suffer as much as possible before you died. We'll get to that a little more when we talk about the crucifixion in just a minute. Each stroke cut into that quivering flesh until the veins and sometimes even the entrails, the intestines of that person were laid bare. Many times those lead balls would knock out eyes or knock out teeth. But it's as if that were not enough. I think even worse than that was the mockery. Over this lacerated body, just imagine all that back and sides just laid open, blood, and they take this purple robe and lay it on his back. Then the verse we read said they set a crown of thorns on his head. The Greek says they pressed a crown of thorns upon his head. In his right hand, they placed a reed for a scepter. A reed was like, you know, when you go out to the river and they got those kind of grass-like things growing up and the long stalks, that's what the reed is. And so they put a reed in his hand for a scepter. And then it says they struck him with rods and staff on his crown-plaited head, like a baseball bat. Think of someone swinging a baseball bat, and they hit his head again and again and again to the point. When they finally took him out, they says, one historian says that his mother hardly could recognize him because his head was so battered and swollen. Took their palms and their hands and their fists and beat him about the face. They bowed down in mockery. They spit on his face over and over again. All this goes on for an hour and a half. Can you imagine that kind of torture for an hour and a half? Finally, between 8:30 and 9, they tell him that you carry your own cross up the hill to be crucified. And so he starts that half-mile journey, what's known as the Via Dolorosa, from the Praetorium up to Golgotha. And he tries to carry, and finally had to get someone to help him, because after all that, his strength is just gone. He can't do it by himself. Well, they get a man named Simon to help him. About 9 o'clock, he's laid down the dead on the cross. We all seen the pictures of the nail prints here in his hands. The nail prints are probably here. This is a part of the hand also. Nail here and in the feet. Again, there's a reason for that. The Romans were torture experts. They wanted them to linger for days on that cross. And so here, it would not, here it could tear out of his hand. Here it could not tear out of his hand. It's held in. They nail his feet. Here's why they nail the feet. Because basically what you do on a cross is you die of suffocation. Because you can't breathe. But when they nail those feet, then when they get a breath, they'd lift themselves up and get a breath, then they'd slump back down again and couldn't breathe again. That way they'd go on like that for days. And the Romans loved it because they were in such torture and agony for all this time. So on Friday, this all started at midnight on Friday morning. So he's on the cross by 9 o'clock, 3 hours. And then at noon, darkness comes on the whole earth. Covers the whole earth for 3 hours, noon to 3 o'clock. During that 3 hours, the veil of the temple is torn from top to bottom. Now, why is that significant? Because up to this time, people would bring their sacrifices to the priest, they'd take them to the holy place, and the priest would prepare the sacrifice in the holy place, and then only the high priest then would take that blood and go behind what's known as the curtain that divided the Holy of Holies from the holy place. And only the high priest could go behind the curtain. About 12 inches thick that curtain was. And it, behind here, it says that the Shekinah glory of God would fall on them and it was all back there. Sometimes they'd even tie a rope to the priest's foot so that if he passed out in worship of God back there, because the Holy Spirit was so magnificent, they could drag him out from under the curtain. You see, he went back there to talk to God to get forgiveness for other people's sins. But during that 3 hours, that veil was torn from top to bottom. And because of that, we know that from now on, after that, we don't have to go to some man to talk to God on our behalf. Praise God, we go straight to the throne room of God.
Amen.
We talk to God. Earthquakes. Was there one? Was there two? I don't know. Was there just one giant? I don't know. But it says earthquakes. And tombs were opened. Oh, and by the way, non-Christian historians have documented that earthquakes took place at that time. The tombs were opened. And the scripture says, over in 1 Corinthians, it says over 500 Christian people who had given their life to God came out of the tombs and showed themselves in the holy city. Kind of hard to argue with a dead person who's come to life again. 3 p.m. Jesus says, "It is finished." And he dismissed the spirit. That's not very long. Romans wanted him on the cross a long time. There's two other criminals there. But you see, the Jews had this law that said nobody could stay on the cross after 6 o'clock, after sundown, because that's when the Sabbath started. And so they wanted him off the cross. You know, they didn't want to be reminded of what they'd done, what was taking place. And so they wanted them down. And so they had to kill them, make sure they were dead. And so they went to each of the prisoners and they broke the legs of the two thieves on the cross next to Jesus. Why'd they break their legs? Remember, they had their feet nailed together so they could lift themselves up to keep from suffocating. But when they broke the legs, they couldn't lift themselves up anymore. And they'd go ahead and suffocate and die so they could take them off the cross. But with Jesus, when they came to Jesus, it says they didn't break his legs because he's already dead. Another prophecy fulfilled that says not one bone of his body would be broken. So they didn't break his legs. But just to make sure he's really dead, they took a spear and drove it through his side. And the scripture says water and blood came flowing forth, which is an indication that they punctured his heart. Kind of does away with the swoon theory. He just passed out from exhaustion. Now he's dead. Got to be buried before 6. So a rich friend of his, Joseph, from Arimathea and goes to Pilate and says, Pilate, could I have his body, please? He takes his body, takes it down, and he takes it to his family tomb that has just recently been hewn out. There's nobody else been used. It's a new tomb. That's important because, see, some folks, there's somebody else that says, oh, no, they just misunderstood. That was really Jesus still in there. Somebody else just got taken out. No, there's only one body in that tomb. And that's the body of our Savior. Man, God thought of everything, didn't he? Buried in a new tomb. Now we're in Friday. Remember, he's in the ground before 6 o'clock on Friday. All day Saturday, 24 hours on Saturday. Then midnight comes on Sunday. He's in the tomb. But sometime before early morning when the ladies came with the spices and all, Jesus was gone. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 3 days, he was in the tomb. Now, at seminary, when you take a preaching lab, they say when you write your sermon, when you finish writing the sermon, here's what you do. You look at your sermon, you say, so what? Because this is where you conclude your sermon. There's got to be a so what to what it is you're teaching your people. So all this stuff we just talked about, let's say it. So what? Why is this so important? Here's what I want you to know. Christ was in heaven. He was being attended to by all the angels, all the comforts over there. He and his Father walked together. He voluntarily left the comforts of heaven, coming here knowing why he was being born and that he was being born to die for us. You know, the scripture says he had to be crucified. Think about this. When people say to you, you are so narrow-minded because you think there's only one way for people to get to heaven. Well, I think there's many ways. Well, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man gets to the Father but by me.
Amen.
But think about this. God would have to be the most sadistic God or the most sadistic being in the entire universe to allow his only son to go through what we just talked about if there was any other way for man to be saved. Who would want to serve a God like that? There had to be a reason he came, because there's no other way whereby men might be saved except the blood of Jesus. Now here's why. Write these verses down and I'll quote them to you and you just write them down. Romans 6:23 says, all have sinned. That means all of us have chosen our way over God's way. And then Romans 5:12 says, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, Adam, and death by sin. And so death passed on all men because all have sinned. In other words, here's what he said. Adam sinned because Adam sinned, Adam had to die. And now, because Adam sinned, we sin. And because Adam had to die for his sin, we someday have to die for our sin. That's why there's going to be a hearse pull up to your door someday. If you never sinned, you'd never die. But there's death. Romans 6:23 says, but the payment for sin is death. We know that we have to die. There has to be a death to pay for our sin. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So now here's the choice. Either I sin, and because I sin, I have to die to pay for my sin. I have to die and go to hell, pay for my sin. Or I can allow Christ's death to be my substitute. You know, some of these people trying to get into college, they pay somebody to take their, pay the substitute to take their ACTs for them. That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? I wish I could have had somebody take my SATs. Here, there's only one substitute that can take my place.
Amen.
Jesus. That's it. I told somebody yesterday, people say to me all the time, I believe in God. That's going to get me to heaven. Listen to Scripture. You believe in God? Good. Even the demons in hell believe in God and shudder. So believing in God, knowing God was true and Jesus was Christ's Son would get you into heaven. When you got there, the demons would be saying, come on in. Because see, they used to be angels in heaven. The devil used to be in heaven. He knows God is real. So why aren't they getting to go if all it takes is a head knowledge? Jesus says, behold, today I stand at your heart's door, I knock. If you'll open the door, let me come in. Man, I'll eat with you and you can eat with me. In other words, today you can be saved. Amen. He says to you by name, I want you to be saved. Pastor, I don't know how to be saved. It is so easy. Amen. Listen, do you believe that God is God and that Christ is God's Son? Yes. Do you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead? Yes. Then you're halfway to heaven. But halfway is as good as hell. So what else does it take? Let me read you another verse. Now listen real close. Romans chapter 10, verse 19. That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. If you confess with your mouth, Jesus, I believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. You must believe in your heart, and you must confess. You must ask for forgiveness. You see, we've all sinned. All of sin falls short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. Romans 3. All of sin. You sin, I sin, we've all sinned. And we've got to be forgiven. So you have to come to the point of getting off your high horse. See, Jesus didn't ride a horse, he rode a donkey. When it came time to serve his disciples, he got on his knees and washed their nasty feet. And you have to become just as humble as Jesus did in order to be saved. You have to humble yourself and say, I can't save myself. I need Jesus to save me. Jesus, please, come into my heart. Forgive me my sins. Come be my Savior. That's all it takes. If you're willing to do that, your sins are washed away. And all that suffering that Jesus went through, all that blood that he shed, that blood covers your sin. So when God looks down from heaven after that, he never sees your sin again. All he sees is the blood of his son Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let's pray together. Maybe this morning you would say, Pastor, I've known about Jesus all my life. I've heard about it. I've been in church. But I've never given my life to Christ. I mean, I do believe, just like you said, I do believe. But I don't know how to pray that prayer. Well, let me do this. I'm gonna pray that prayer with you. These friends around you are going to pray it with me out loud this morning. And if you'll pray that prayer, and you'll really mean it when you say it. It's not about the words you say, it's about meaning it when you say it. If you'll pray that prayer this morning, right where you sit, Jesus will forgive all your sins. And he will give you eternal life right now. So I'm gonna lead you through this prayer. And saints of God, to make it easy for those who want to pray it, I want to ask you, would you just repeat it after me as we pray, please? So let's pray together. Holy Father, I confess to you that I am a guilty sinner. I need to be saved. So I do believe that Jesus is your son. And I do believe that you raised Jesus from the dead. And if you can do that, you can forgive my sins. So I'm asking you, God, would you forgive all my sins? And let Jesus' blood cover my sins. Give me eternal life. I choose Jesus as my Savior right now. Jesus' name I pray.